Hello, and welcome back to Cinema 105, Media and Society. We are in week 8. We're covering advertising today, and this week is a little bit different. The lecture is going to run a little longer, and we're going to have four discussion questions. As a result, I've eliminated a homework assignment. So what I want you to have done is done the reading. It's 6 or 7 pages from a book called Cryptoscatology. That is in week 8. And I want you to have read that prior to starting this lecture. That's your homework. You don't have to write anything about it, but you have to read it before you start this lecture. And the questions in the lecture and the information lecture will build on what you've read. Okay, so a little bit longer lecture and discussion, but less homework to balance things out. Okay. So let's go ahead and get to it. I'll share my screen. All right. So as you can see here, we're going to talk about advertising. Week 8, advertising, media and society. So we see advertising everywhere. Everywhere we go, it fills our line of sight, particularly billboards as we see here. Today, the topics that we're going to discuss, we're going to introduce some stats, talk about the research tools of advertisers, and then we'll get into notes from the reading. That's from Cryptoscatology, including a discussion of Sigmund Freud. Then we'll get into Edward Bernays, a really important figure in advertising and PR history. We'll talk about the art movement surrealism and its effect on advertising. Also, we'll get into older versus newer advertising, how they're different. Talk about appeals to emotion, sex and female objectification in advertising. Well, lastly, we'll wrap up with vows, which is discussed in your reading, and woke advertising. So make sure that you've read the script Cryptoscatology prior to starting the lecture. If you haven't, stop now, go back and read it. And we're going to have 4 questions. So just want to make sure everybody's on the same page. So advertising pays for most of our content. Okay, no advertising, no TV shows. They don't make them for their health. They make them to sell advertising time and make a profit. And, you know, advertising pays for programming. Look at the numbers that are being spent here. Okay, these are in billions. So 61 billion, 65 billion, 67 billion. These are the enormous numbers that are being spent in advertising. Now, they're not spending that money and not getting some return. They know that it works. They know when they spend advertising dollars, it results in sales. So the advertising landscape is changing. We've discussed this in other areas of the class. As you can see, the internet spend from 2012 to now, the internet spend is only increasing. Whereas print here in red and gray has gotten smaller. Television, radio holding the same. The internet is eating away at print advertising's money, which we've discussed at several other times in the class, okay? So difference between the youth and the old, okay? So generational difference. Socials for Gen X and millennials are the number one, as we can see here in the pink, whereas in the blue, TV for the older generations, okay? Even including Gen Xers. That's the way it breaks down. Big surprise. We've seen this repeated many times in the class. So advertisers are increasingly marketing to the youth online. I believe this was discussed earlier in the class. So I'm talking millennials and Gen Z are where the advertisers' dollars are going because they're the ones that are growing up, buying things, need a car, need a home, need all of the appliances that their parents have already bought. So advertisers study human behavior. They study the effects of their advertising. They don't just do this blindly. They don't throw billions and billions of dollars around without having studied the effects of those dollars. So every click, every purchase, every website you visit is tracked. And they also, these are AI tools to automate their tracking. In person, they also do focus groups, surveys, interviews, as you see here, with their target audience. They also observe. Here's a couple of the things that they do, focus groups, customer surveys, and you can get paid to do these. They have video surveillance in stores, and of course, they're tracking all of your purchases. So they have an idea of what works. They know when they release a commercial and they see an uptick in sales, that's because of that commercial. So ads are everywhere eyeballs are, Okay. Ads are everywhere eyeballs are. And here we see a street. This is probably Broadway area of New York, completely inundated with advertising. And let's go to Marshall McLuhan. Now, this is from the reading that you have done. This is a little excerpt. He says, ads are the cave art of the 20th century. We ignore the hidden environment of magical forms that we call ads. Like cave paintings, ads are not intended to be looked at or seen, but rather to exert influence at a distance, as if through ESP. They're not private means, but corporate expression. They are vortices of collective power, massive energy invented by new tribal man. So look at what he's talking about here. No one goes over to the bus stop and reads this ad. They just happen to glance at it while they're waiting for the bus. Otherwise, they mostly ignore it. We don't pay attention to ads. So, but they are the cave art of the 20th century. Everywhere we look, we see advertising. We unconsciously train ourselves to ignore it, but yet millions are spent on it, and they know that they work. Most people think they don't work on them as if they can organize it, as can ignore them. But studies show that just having the ads constantly in our environment influences us greatly, and the sales prove it. So back to McLuhan, advertising is the only good news in the newspaper. You think about it. Most of the newspaper is bad news about what's happened, and most advertising is good news about a product, what could happen if you make a purchase. Advertising is the greatest art form of the 20th century. That's a great statement. Let's explore that one a little bit more. So advertising is the dominant art form of the 20th century. We've seen way more ads than we have actual art. And even some art, like Andy Warhol's soup cans, some fine art began to look like advertising. So you literally have seen millions of ads in your life, but how many works of art have you seen? Andy Warhol understood his art began to look like a printed ads. Here is one of his paintings dealing with Maryland, but it has this sort of repeated quality of print and advertising. Ads are everywhere, but art is in museums. Digital marketing experts estimate that Americans are exposed to around 4,000 to 10,000 ads each day. Each day. That's up from something like 400 or 500 back in the 70s. But literally trillions of ads, trillions of commercials are viewed every day. So let's get into the reading. That was our setup. That was our intro. The book we're reading from is called Cryptoscatology, Conspiracy Theory as Art Form. Robert Guffey is actually a professor at Long Beach State in Long Beach. So here's some terms. Surrealism is an art movement with dream imagery. Artists are guerrilla surrealists. Advertisers are corporate surrealists. Guerrilla surrealists wish to incite revolt. Corporate surrealists wish to incite compliance. Advertising exists everywhere in our world but goes unnoticed. We've touched on that. And then we'll also get into emotional appeals and the use of sex. This is all covered in the reading. So first up, a brief introduction to Sigmund Freud. Here's a photo. He was an Austrian neurologist and founder of psychoanalysis, a clinical method for evaluating and treating pathology in the psyche through dialogue with a patient and an analyst. Almost everything we think of psychoanalysis can at least be tracked in some part back to Freud. His ideas were improved upon, some of them even rejected, but he got the ball rolling. He introduced the world to the concept of talking out your problems with someone that could understand them. And Freud exposed the hidden motivations in human behavior to explain the various issues his clients faced. Repressed feelings forced down in the psyche would reemerge in odd and even sometimes destructive behaviors in humans. So he had this concept of the mind. We have the conscious mind, and he expressed it as an iceberg. We know about an iceberg that there's much more below the water than there is above. Well, what's above is just what's floating on top. And this is where we have the conscious mind, things that you're aware of, the words that I'm saying in my mouth right now, the visuals that you're looking at. Then you have your preconscious mind, and those can be things like memory. You can call what your birthday is, what day of the week it is. It's not in your conscious mind right now, but you can easily recall it. Then there's the unconscious mind, which is further below, deeper down into the water. And these are the things that you're not consciously aware of. Your hidden desires, your secret thoughts, even your urges, your fears, they all exist within the unconscious mind, Freud said. And it was his theory that it was this unconscious mind that had a tremendous and hidden unseen effect on our decision-making that crept up into our conscious mind in unforeseen ways. So here's a little further breakdown. Here's the iceberg analogy again. We have the conscious mind, the small amount of mental activity we know about, things we could be aware of or if we wanted to try, like remembering the name of a friend, that's our subconscious. Then we have the unconscious, okay? Unconscious drives, fears, unaccepted sexual desires, violent motives, irrational wishes, immoral urges, selfish needs, shameful experiences, and even traumatic experiences. If something horrible has happened to us, often those memories and those effects are pushed down into our unconscious, okay? So Freud's ideas were considered dangerous, and they were a real threat to the status quo. Many people wrote about this. He was run out of some places, but eventually they did spread and take hold. His ideas shocked the elite. He suggested that lurking inside everyone were hidden unconscious desires that were the real motivators for human action. The masses were truly unruly and they needed to be managed. So Freudian motivation theory posits that unconscious psychological forces such as hidden desires and motives shape an individual's behavior, including their purchasing patterns. Okay, Freudian motivation theory is frequently applied to a number of disciplines, including sales and marketing, to help understand the consumer's motivations when it comes to making a purchase or a decision. So here we see an example, beautiful but dumb. She has never learned the first rule of lasting charm, a long-lasting deodorant. So this isn't telling you about the quality of the deodorant. This is really playing on your emotions, your fear of being considered dumb or smelling bad. This is really a playing on the emotions of the person who sees this ad. Fear and social status are used to motivate the purchase. It appeals to emotion, not rational thought. So the person that is most responsible for doing this is a man by the name of Edward Bernays, okay? And he was Freud's American nephew, all right? And Freud sent to his nephew, Edward Bernays. Edward Bernays lived in America. He was a very important figure. We'll learn that in a moment. He sent him a copy of his latest book as a present, his book on psychoanalysis. The book spoke of deep unconscious drives in the human mind that were the real motivator of behavior. Bernays introduced these concepts to American advertising in the 1920s. And by the 1950s, they were universally accepted. Also in the 1950s, Freudian psychoanalysis slowly was introduced to the US and became more popular. Bernays said, if we understand the mechanism and motives of the group mind, it is now possible to control and regiment the masses according to our will without them knowing it. So who is Bernays? Father of the public relations industry. He literally founded the very first one. Master of propaganda, nephew to Sigmund Freud, the great psychoanalyst. He was in Woodrow Wilson, that's the president's World War I administration in the teens and 20s. He was hired by numerous corporations to promote their interests and influence public purchases, okay? He says, the only difference between propaganda and education really is the point of view. The advocacy of what we believe in is education. The advocacy of what we don't believe in is propaganda. So he's the OG of the advertising and public relations industries, the original guru. His books are the industry manual. He engineered the public relations effort behind America's World War I effort. In other words, you know, creating the slogans and so forth, and the U.S. backed coup, which overthrew the democratic government of Guatemala. He's very instrumental in a lot of these activities. So here's a couple of things summarizing him up. His slogans, make the world safe for democracy. That's what they used in World War I to convince Americans to support the war. Lighting a torch for freedom. We'll come back to that one. So selling World War I to Americans, making President Wilson a hero to the world, getting women to smoke. Yes, we have Edward Bernays to thank for that. Fluoridation of the U.S. water. He was behind the PR campaign to convince the public that it was okay to insert what was thought of as a dangerous chemical into our water supply. Making bacon and eggs ideal breakfast. Did you have that today? Well, you can thank Bernays. selling Kate mix to housewives, making the piano popular, and of course, PR campaigns for U.S. Covert actions. With Bernays, products and service became the manifestation of personal expression. He was the first to place brands with celebrity endorsers and plant products in movies. He was the first to make luxury an achievable accomplishment for the middle and lower classes. So let's take a look at an example here. This is the Tortures of Freedom campaign. So in the early 20s, it was still taboo for women to smoke in public. Some would do it privately, but it was considered very unladylike to do that in public. So working for the Lucky Strike brand, that's a cigarette brand, Bernays linked cigarettes to the women's liberation movement, which had only just had its major success in 1920 with the women getting the vote. So he staged a demonstration at the 1929 Easter Parade in New York. He had fashionable young women called debutantes photographed flaunting their torches of freedom in front of journalists he had positioned to photograph them. He staged the entire event and gave the slogan to the women to say. Sales of cigarette to women began to take off. The brand became the symbol of gender equality in the U.S. during those years. So look, we have the Statue of Liberty as a great symbol for America. What is it? It's a woman holding a torch. So Tortures of Freedom became synonymous with women's liberation, women's getting the vote, and essentially asking for and getting more rights within the civilization. So here's a quote from Noam Chomsky. What really propelled him into fame in the late 20s was getting women to smoke. Women didn't smoke in those days, and he ran a huge ad campaigns for Chesterfields using the techniques we all know, models and movie stars with cigarettes coming out of their mouth. Here's Ronald Reagan, who later went on to become president, selling some Chesterfield cigarettes. So, you know, Bernays was the first to do that. In 1929, public relations was a new experimental field that Bernays had effectively invented. His hugely successful campaign to encourage women to smoke became the stuff of legends, okay? Here's another one quickly. We've all heard the expression, the hearty breakfast. You know, we sort of know that you got to eat a big breakfast for every morning, and that bacon and a lot of meat are part of that. Well, Bernays bribed about 5,000 physicians to sign a statement that agreed a protein-rich, heavy breakfast of bacon and eggs was healthier than a light one. He did this at the request of a Beechnut Packing Company, which sold bacon, which was the sales of which were flagging. The petition was published in newspapers, and the All-American Breakfast was born with a huge spike in sales for bacon. So notice that Bernays' techniques, he just doesn't come out and say, hey, everybody buy bacon. He does something that says, hey, this is a really good idea over here, and here's experts that support the idea. The purchase of bacon only follows as a result of the new announcement. So different tricks. He did an extensive psychoanalysis of consumers, not necessarily him himself, but people he hired, market research, celebrity endorsements, manipulating the press, manipulating Hollywood. Very high level connections. He lived in a huge, gorgeous mansion, an entire floor in Central Park South, a very expensive address overlooking Central Park in New York. He bribed experts, generating free publicity for himself. He knew everyone. He was very well connected in the government, in advertising, and in corporate America. His techniques became the manual. And he said once, men are rarely aware of the real reasons which motivate their actions. And this was a trademark of Bernays. He never tried to directly motivate, tried to overtly influence, mentioning the product in his PR campaigns. Very often, he motivated people very subtly, and the purchase of the product came only after a few steps later in his motivation scenario. So coming into 1950s America, when these practices became more common in America, what we see is the birth of consumerism. Bernays took Freud a step further by concluding that in order to maintain society, humanity need to be pacified, that lurking within all these humans were these unconscious motivations, and that these need to be watched out for. It was the job of government, and especially big business, to satiate the people, keeping them docile. The key to accomplishing this would be to make them consumers. So American society was transformed over several decades from a collectivist culture. That's what we had during the Great Depression, everyone pitching in, helping out, to individualistic consumers. Hey, you can buy things that make your life easier. So with Renee's, products and services became manifestations of personal expressions, as we see here in the image. During the post-war boom in the 1950s, Americans felt free to consume luxury items freely. Keeping up with the Joneses, your neighbors, became a part of American life. So before Renee's, most people purchased goods for their durability and functionality. They bought things based on need. But Renee's taught his big business clients to use broadcast media to tell a different story. It was a story not based on facts, but on emotions and desires. TV adds so much to family happiness. They're not talking about the product, its cost, its value, its durability. They're talking about the emotions that you'll feel once you have it. By appealing to our aspirations, he could sell us anything, making us happy, leaving us wanting more and more. Consumerism grew to become the heartbeat of the American lifestyle. Now, when I say consumerism, I mean the purchase of products, continual purchase of products to make your life better, replacing old products and so forth. So the 1950s was a time of conformity. Many people just sought to be like the mainstream cultural idea. They sought to keep up with the Joneses, their neighbors. And often that was done through purchases they saw advertised on television. It was even in some cultures, in some periods of time, it was considered okay for pregnant women to smoke. We now know that's absurd. One of the best ways to control people in terms of attitudes is called fabricating consumers. This is from Noam Chomsky. If you can fabricate once, make obtaining things that are just about within your reach the essence of life, you're going to be trapped into becoming consumers. So this is what was created in American society. It's transforming us from a collective of citizens to individualistic consumers. So we're going to wrap with this little excerpt from Mad Men. Now, if you haven't seen it, Mad Men is a television series on AMC. It's now concluded, that was about the ad agencies of the 1950s into the 60s. And all the ads, agencies and campaigns that you see in that show were actually historically referenced. There were actual campaigns that were created, not by the characters, of course, that's for dramatic purposes, but let's just watch this ad campaign and you'll see the application of the psychology that I'm talking about. Here we go.
For many shades of lipstick, one that belongs to her. From a basket of kisses, she picks one. It makes her unique. It colors her kiss, and her kiss, well, it colors her man. Belle Jolie lipstick, mark your man. I only see one lipstick in your drawing. Women want colors, lots and lots of colors. Mark your man. It's pretty cute. Oh, you like this? Well, maybe we should cut down to five shades or one. I'm not telling you to listen to anyone, but this is a very fresh approach.
It's okay, Kevin. I don't think there's much else to do here, but call it a day. Gentlemen, thank you for your time.
Is that all?
You're a non-believer. Why should we waste time on kabuki?
I don't know what that means.
It means that you've already tried your plan and you're number four. You've enlisted my expertise and you've rejected it to go on the way you've been going. I'm not interested in that. You can understand.
I don't think your 3 months or however many thousands of dollars entitles you to refocus the core of our business.
Listen, I'm not here to tell you about Jesus. You already know about Jesus. Either he lives in your heart or he doesn't. Every woman wants choices. But in the end, none wants to be one of 100 in a box. She's unique. She makes the choices and she's chosen him. She wants to tell the world he's mine. He belongs to me, not you. She marks her man with her lips. He is her possession. You've given every girl that wears your lipstick the gift of total ownership.
Okay, now this was an actual campaign for Belle Jolie lipstick. Mark your man. Again, it has nothing to do with the rational qualities of the product. It has everything to do with the irrational associations of ownership of your husband. Okay, so this brings us to question one. Here we are. How did Bernays change American advertising and what effect did it have? How did Bernays change American advertising and what effect did it have? Now, of course, Bernays wasn't the only one. He introduced the ideas and they spread, but he was the introducer. He was the one that promoted them and first used them. So how did Bernays change American advertising and what effect did it have? That's question one. Okay. There are going to be four questions today, so get ready. And of course, you can always stop. You don't have to watch this in one setting. You can always stop and come back to it, as I know many of you have. Moving on. Okay, now let's talk about surrealism. That's brought up very much in the reading from Cryptoscatology. And surrealism is a 20th century avant-garde art movement, and also in literature, that sought to release the creative potential of the unconscious mind. Sound familiar? By the irrational juxtaposition of images. And we see examples here from M.C. Escher and René Magritte. They were powerfully influenced by Sigmund Freud. The surrealists believed the conscious mind repressed the power of the imagination, weighing it down with taboos. In some ways, surrealists were the first CGI, computer-generated images. They created images that can only be seen in dreams. So surrealists saw art as a weapon. It was done in reaction to the violence and brutality of World War I. We're talking the 20s now. They wanted to create a revolution of thinking in the population. And they rejected automation that was happening at the time and the groupthink that had led to World War I. And they created fantastic images like what you see here, okay? One of the great masters was Salvador Dali. You may have heard of him. See some of his, here he is here, some of his very trippy, surrealistic paintings in which he combines images, does impossible things that, you know, we had never seen before. More of Salvador Dali's work. He was the most famous and recognized and popular of the surrealists. There were many others. Picasso dabbled in the form. Here are some modern images of surrealism. So surrealism isn't just locked in time. People have been doing surrealist images since the 20s. We see surrealism in sci-fi. And consider, before we invent the technology to go to space, we had to first imagine it. And so a lot of sci-fi novels and surrealistic art imagined what the future would be like or what it would be like to do certain things long before we actually could. We see surrealism in commercial art. Here's a great example. You know, shocking images that attract your eye are crucial in modern advertising. Surrealism has been a very useful tool to tap into the public's unconscious. So while the artist tried to, you know, incite revolution, advertisers are trying to tap into your conscious to get you to make a purchase. Now, CGI in movies is surrealism pushed to its extreme. Here we see from Pan's Labyrinth and here from the Marvel movies, a lot of use of CGI, computer-generated images in films that basically can make anything you can dream up of, make it come to life. Bernays also said about the American motion picture that it was the greatest unconscious carrier of propaganda in the world today. It is a great distributor for ideas and opinions. And here we see, you know, several films which have promoted different aspects of American culture, and including propaganda films like Pearl Harbor or Argo. We also see corporate surrealism. So we see corporations using surrealism to attract your eye first. Here's a commercial for Lee Jeans, but then, you know, essentially get you to make a purchase, doing something that we feel as surrealistic in this way. Corporate surrealism here is for facial essence material. I'm not sure what they're selling there. We see a lot of these kind of blended images. Here we take a photograph and it turns into the shape of the bottle they're trying to sell. So this is very popular in corporations and advertising. Here's another commercial for a shoe, one for a hair care product. Corporate surrealism, very popular. So surrealism was art's attempt to bend reality to its will and show the audience something they could only dream of. Well, advertisers want to do the same thing. Surrealism is used to show the audience waking dreams of a better life in order to sell them products. Okay, and here we see examples here. If you can grab their attention with a wild, bizarre image, it's easier to hold that attention and sell them. So let's look at a couple examples of surrealism. And as we do this, we're going to talk also about the differences between older and newer advertising, okay? So here's two surrealistic images, okay? They're surreal, super real. This one's from the past, like maybe the 20s or 30s. And what I want you to notice about it is how much words, how much written language is used, okay? On the market for 20 years, 1.5 million bottles sold. Those are rational appeals. Make children and adults fat as pigs. I mean, that's still surrealistic, but lots of words. Now look at the modern example. There's no words, okay? There might be another, there's probably somewhere down here that got cut off in the image, but there's no real words in the ads. It's all visual. It's all conveyed by visual clues. The naked, probably beautiful woman, the cell phone coming out of the pocket. Modern ads feature fewer words. They're more visual, not literal. Let's look at examples. So here's old advertising for Coca-Cola. Not surrealistic, but it's a simple ad for Coca-Cola, but they're explaining in words, lots of words, what they want you to do and why you should buy it. Now, this is because newspapers were the dominant media and circulation was wide. Newspapers explained with words, so did the ads. They're appealing to the rational mind. As we move further into the 20th century, visual media takes over, okay? Modern advertising is visually focused, like modern society. TV, movies, video games now are the dominant media, okay? That's been true since, you know, really been happening since the start of the 21st century. Now, technology makes amazing surrealistic images easy, appealing to emotion and the irrational minds with images and symbols. So this is a somewhat surrealistic image, but there's almost no words. It's just the name of the product and a visual association, a surrealistic image to grab your attention. So old advertising is very literate, lots of words. Modern advertising is very visual, mostly images. Older advertising explains, it's rational. Modern advertising urges, it's more irrational. Appeals to mind, appeals to emotion. Old advertising is limited by the technology of the time, whereas modern advertising is liberated by the technology of the time. Both display the dominant social values in their images and words, okay? Depending on what those values are at the time, as we'll see. So old advertising versus modern. Here again, we see an older advertisement for a car, and you see all the writing, the tiny print, the large print, lots and lots of information about the vehicle. Here's a modern ad, almost no written information. In fact, they have what they call the fine print, which does give you some detail. It's so tiny that no one actually reads it. It's not presented in a way that's meant to be read. It's almost shoved off the page and made so tiny as to be insignificant, okay? Older advertising for a literary culture, newer advertising for a much more visually driven culture, which you and your generation are. Cars connote lifestyle, and the way that they're sold is the conveyance of that lifestyle. This is what Bernays taught advertisers. So a convertible looks and performance. This is being sold to someone that really wants to be flashy and show off. Jaguar, grace, space, and pace. So this is, you look with a castle in the background. This is being sold to show the prestige of the Jaguar van. Now this is a Pinto, which was a common man's car, relatively cheap back in the day. Well, they're showing common people just having fun doing common things. So cars and lifestyles, very linked. This is what Bernays taught advertisers. Also, of course, connecting to image and to sexuality. So somehow using women or using an image here, we have some sort of rebel figure buying the new Dodge. And it's not about the rational advantages of the car. It's about the irrational emotion that's evoked by the car. And that's what makes people make those purchases. So now what we're gonna do is take a look at a few TV ads that illustrate this principle. So we're gonna watch two videos coming up. We're gonna watch two car commercials, one from the 50s and one from 2014. I want you to watch each and you're gonna answer discussion question two after, okay? So we're going to watch two commercials, and then you're going to have a question about those two commercials in the question section. So remember, McLuhan reminds us, we don't buy products. We buy how they make us feel. Okay? So here we go. Here's our first example, everybody. Let's watch. You might need to turn up the volume. Sometimes the volumes are lower. Maybe you need to turn it down. Here we go.
Hello, I'm Truman Bradley, speaking for your local Chrysler dealer. And tonight I have a real challenge for you. Because we believe that 15 minutes here can change 15 years of car buying habits. And that's especially true if you now drive one of the two major competitive cars in Chrysler's price class. In fact, every day, more and more folks just like you are making the big switch to the exciting new 56 Chrysler. But let's spend a Saturday morning with the owners of this sleek new power style Chrysler, and I'll show you some of the reasons why. Notice how your neighbors look with admiration as you drive out in your new Chrysler. And no wonder, from the rakish flare of its new flight-swept rear fenders, right up to its bold but elegant new front styling, the new power style Chrysler emphasizes the forward look of power in motion.
Looks like it's still moving, even when it stops.
Some design.
And now let's go with the missus for the Saturday shopping. Well, here's a young man who's mighty impressed.
Wow, another new Chrysler. That rear end looks just like a jet plane.
Eno.
Okay, this is a commercial from the 50s. It might appear to us as being corny because it's so in front of us. They're not being subtle at all. And I want to ask you, are they showing us the car or are they telling us about the car? Okay, let's move on to the next one.
Hello, I'm Truman.
Okay, so here's a modern car commercial from 2014. For a Maserati, also a luxury vehicle like the one we just looked at. Here we go. Now, the sound on this one is a little bit problematic. It may not come up. I've tried to work that out. We'll do the best we can. Wow, he owns a plane and has a younger girlfriend or wife. So what we're wondering here is, what I want to ask you as we now move into the question phase is, did that last commercial show or tell us? What were the differences between those two commercials? Obviously, the later one looked a lot better. It was produced with better looking cameras. Don't talk about that. How were they different and how they tried to convince the watcher of those commercials to buy the car? They both had a psychological pitch, but they were very subtly different, or actually very obviously different. So let's move to the question. Discuss three differences between the old car commercial and newer one. Okay, we just watched those. So what were the three differences between, give me at least three, you can give me more if you can think of them, between those two car commercials and their approach to selling to the consumer, okay? And this really ties into everything we've talked about in the lecture up till point, the psychological manipulation, the emotional appeals, but also a visual versus a literary or spoken culture, okay? So that's question two. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and move on. You guys can stop and take time to answer that, or you can come with me. Okay, up next we have appeals to emotion, okay? So this is anytime an advertiser really tries to pull at your heartstrings, to not make a rational, conscious mind appeal, but to appeal to your emotion, your sense of what's right or wrong, your feelings, your fears, your hopes, your desires. So advertising appeals to whatever values are important to you, the consumer. In this case, motherhood, environmentalism, family. They're selling Lysol, which I'm pretty sure is an aerosol spray, which is damaging to the app, to the environment. They're using motherhood and care for animals as a way to sell that. Here's an old ad. The old ads you'll notice are much, much more obvious because as advertising progressed, it got more subtle. These old advertisements seem almost corny. They're too obvious to us, but they worked back in the day as advertising and the consumers progressed, got more advanced, the advertising got more subtle. It couldn't be so obvious. So here it says, are you unpopular with your children? Make sure you don't have halitosis. That's bad breath, by the way. So here's a whole ad about bad breath. So words are often used to evoke emotion, and emotions are really important in advertising. Fear, guilt, trust, value, belonging. If you can evoke an emotion in a consumer, you're going to have a much higher likelihood of them making a purchase. And what the point here is, and this is what Bernays showed advertisers, that people make their choices, particularly their purchasing choices, as much or more based on irrational emotional decisions. Oh, this is cool. This is hip. Everyone's getting it. Oh, I'll feel better. I'll look like I'm cool if I have this product. They do that more than they base their decisions on rational choices. Okay. So here it is broken down. This is from the reading, the Cryptoscatology. This is Jerry Delafima. He was a successful American ad executive, and he's a supporter of the vowel system, which we'll talk about in our final section of the class. So advertising deals in open source, fear, greed, anger. You name the dwarves, bashful or grumpy, and we play on every one. We play on all the emotions, on all the problems that people have, from not getting ahead to the desire to be one of the crowd. Everyone has a button. If enough people have the same button, you have a successful ad and a successful product. So here we have talk of the perfect body, where they've got some impossibly beautiful and young models there to sort of make you feel guilty about your own body. Here we have something for bad breath. This is for Colgate bad breath, a little sign of garlic, playing on the fear that a lot of people have that they have bad breath and they don't know it, and they offend people in public. So in both examples, they're subtly playing on people's own insecurities, okay? Fear is an effective advertising tool. And here I have a bunch of different examples. Happiness is freedom from fear. Alerting customers to potential bad outcomes is highly effective. These ads shock the consumer with their images and claims. Once alerted, they will look for relief. That's when you offer the product. Okay, so here's something. This is a clear use of fear. They're trying to get people to stop smoking. It's probably a good thing. We know that's not healthy, but they're using fear to do it. Fear of destroying your laptop. We've all done that once or twice. It will be too late when the sirens sound. Let us build your fallout bomb shelter. That's fear. That's driving fear. Okay, getting you to think about something maybe you haven't thought of before. And then you look for something to relieve that fear. Here's more examples. You know, the Hummer sales took off after 9/11. Okay, 9/11, the famous attack on America in 2001, first time we've been attacked in half a century. After the September 11 attacks, market research suggested the public were now terrified of the outside generally. PR agents sought to exploit the consumer's reptile brain. That's where you process fear. The reptilian brain could be triggered to sell big military style cars. So these huge cars made people feel safer. They set up very high. They had a huge bumper and they felt like they could just roll over anyone in their way. Remember, advertising is about selling freedom from fear and targeting consumers' anxieties with products that will alleviate these worries. Freud said, unexpressed emotions will never die. They are buried alive and will come forth later in uglier ways. He's talking about our unconscious motivations. Another example, fear in advertising, how fear of bird flu sold soap. There's virtually no difference between the traditional bar and antibacterial soap. But in the 90s, the bird flu pandemic and panic popularized the use of antibacterial soap. Okay, does this sound familiar? Like maybe COVID-19? Fear was used to sell products and promote public health. Humans respond to potential threats more than any other emotional stimuli. Now, we've covered this before, but basically, fear of something bad happening is a greater motivator than hope of something good happening. And it makes a natural sense. It's sort of a preservation mechanism. Something that's a danger to you gets highest priority over something that might just be a benefit or pleasurable. So we all had to buy these different products to go back to school, hand sanitizer. Here was an ad from Australia where they used this very dire example of a fear, showing a young woman on a breathalyzer to survive, on a breath machine to survive, to get people to get vaccinated for COVID-19. Now, this isn't illegal, and most people wouldn't even say it's immoral, but it is playing on humans' emotions to accomplish a task. Fear and insecurity. Many products use shame and FOMO to entice customers into a purchase. Here we see an ad for Axe body spray. Okay, so if you use Axe body spray, you won't be, I guess, fat and hairy. That'll make you more desirable. Any issue in life can be resolved with a purchase once you've tapped in to someone's insecurities. Now, Axe body spray is, I think, primarily bought by young men. That's their target audience. What are young men concerned about? Appearing attractive, not appearing square. They have insecurities which are played on in the ads. Emotion is more effective than logic in advertising, okay? 31% of advertisers report significant profit gains with emotional campaigns as opposed to rational campaigns, okay? If you make your campaign emotional somehow, in other words, you're appealing to people's fears and insecurities, their unconscious, hidden unconscious desires, you're gonna have a successful campaign. And speaking of which, here it is, sex. Now that we have your attention, eat at Subway. So marketing, doing anything to get your attention. So here we have all these different ads which deploy sexuality in different ways. Some of them are demeaning. Some of them are just fun. I mean, I don't know what's being sold here. Dolce & Gabbana is a handbag company, clothing company, but this looks like a BDSM dungeon. I can't cook, who cares? Hello, boys. These are all using sexuality to attract the eye, using the naked male, a female form or male form to attract the eye and pull you into a product which may or may not have anything to do with sexuality. Sometimes sexuality is very obvious, using very dramatic photos to attract attention. What's for sale here? Bags, booze, bodies? I mean, the bodies take up a huge percentage of the page, but again, they're not just selling the product, they're selling the lifestyle. If you're drinking Sky Infusions vodka, then you know, you're gonna be hanging out with these type of people. Again, track the idea, attract the eyes, and then go from there. Sex and danger is often combined. You know, you see, look at a killer, this guy's a killer. You know, dangerous, you know, to be dangerous is to also be very sexual. And here we have bad boy Dennis Rodman, a former NBA player who was known for his antics, selling some sort of horrible vodka called Bad Boy Vodka. Fear, sex, and guilt are often combined, okay? Are you beach body ready? That's playing on your own guilt of not having worked out or ate too much over the holidays. And they put a young, beautiful, perfect person up there to compare yourself to. Using fear is more than a warning about deadly outcomes. FOMO, or fear of missing out, is a tremendous motivator. Playing on consumers' insecurities, their fears about themselves, is highly effective, particularly amongst the young who are still forming their identities, okay? 56% of consumers report they're afraid of missing something such as an event, news, important status update, if they don't keep an eye on their social networks. Consumers remember one thing and one thing only. So make it scary. We all get inundated with information all day in our through the internet, on our phone, through social medias. So you've got one shot to get somebody's attention. So make that one thing scary. Not all fear selling is about the horrors of bad breath and a potential terrorist attack. Some target the plain old fear of missing out. Fear of missing out drives the upgrade culture around smartphones and technology. It drives the fashion industry. Any industry which is constantly wanting you to buy new versions of the products is often operating on fear. Hey, parents, you don't want to upset your children. Better buy them the latest toys that fit with their other toys. Using sex ironically, sometimes advertisers will do that. Sabrina demonstrates the world's finest projection equipment. Of course, you remember the Carl Jr. ads, which featured very salacious models eating burgers in a provocative way. Advertising tropes have become well-known, and they can now be made fun of, essentially winking at the public with a cheeky mocking of their own techniques. Still using sexuality. Also, this leads us to a discussion of female objectification. One of advertising's greatest ploys is the female body surrealistically melded into your favorite products. products which appeal directly to men and may even incorporate this into the product design. I mean, the shape of the Corvette was definitely meant to be curvaceous and sensual. Here we see a woman's body morphed into, what is this, barbecue sauce? So we see female objectification throughout advertising. You know, women dressed in ridiculous outfits when it doesn't make sense. Now, this one's interesting. Here we have Pamela Anderson caping for PETA, which is an organization which supports animal rights. But even though we might think of them as a liberal organization, they've definitely turned her into a product. This is definite female objectification. So women in their bodies are used to sell products. While nudes in art are historically common, only in the 20th century has the near nude female form been used to sell products or services. Those bodies are photoshopped into perfection. So typical beer ads, but lung donors. So here we see a beer ad where they're doing that, but here's a lung donor, which is, you know, using this a beautiful young woman to, again, attract viewers. We do also see male objectification, but primarily we see it with women. So let's take a look at a great video which discusses this at length. So you may have to turn up the volume once again, but this is a great video with Gene Kilbourne on this subject.
Sometimes people say to me, you've been talking about this for 40 years. Have things gotten any better? And actually, I have to say, really, they've gotten worse. Ads sell more than products. They sell values. They sell images. They sell concepts of love and sexuality, of success, and perhaps most important, of normalcy. To a great extent, they tell us who we are and who we should be. Well, what does advertising tell us about women? It tells us, as it always has, that what's most important is how we look. So the first thing the advertisers do is surround us with the image of ideal female beauty. Women learn from a very early age that we must spend enormous amounts of time, energy, and above all money, striving to achieve this look and feeling ashamed and guilty when we fail. And failure is inevitable because the ideal is based on absolute flawlessness. She never has any lines or wrinkles. She certainly has no scars or blemishes. Indeed, she has no pores. And the most important aspect of this flawlessness is that it cannot be achieved. No one looks like this, including her. And this is the truth. No one looks like this. The supermodel Cindy Crawford once said, "I wish I looked like Cindy Crawford." She doesn't, she couldn't, because this is a look that's been created for years through airbrushing and cosmetics, but these days it's done through the magic of computer retouching. Keira Knightley is given a bigger bust. Jessica Alba is made smaller. Kelly Clarkson, well, this is an interesting, it says slim down your way, but she in fact slimmed down the Photoshop way. You almost never see a photograph of a woman considered beautiful that hasn't been Photoshopped. We all grow up in a culture in which women's bodies are constantly turned into things, into objects. Here she's become the bottle of Michelob. In this ad, she becomes part of a video game. And this is everywhere in all kinds of advertising. Women's bodies turned into things, into objects. Now, of course, this affects female self-esteem. It also does something even more insidious. It creates a climate in which there's widespread violence against women. I'm not at all saying that an ad like this directly causes violence. It's not that simple. But turning a human being into a thing is almost always the first step toward justifying violence against that person. We see this with racism. We see it with homophobia. We see it with terrorism. It's always the same process. The person is dehumanized and violence then becomes inevitable. And that step is already and constantly taken with women. Women's bodies are dismembered in ads, hacked apart. Just one part of the body is focused upon, which of course is the most dehumanizing thing you could do to someone. Everywhere we look, women's bodies turned into things and often just parts of things. And girls are getting the message these days so young that they need to be impossibly beautiful, hot, sexy, extremely thin, and they also get the message that they're going to fail, that there's no way to really achieve it. Girls tend to feel fine about themselves when they're 8, 9, 10 years old, but they hit adolescence and they hit a wall. And certainly part of this wall is this terrible emphasis on physical perfection.
Okay, we'll stop right there. If you're interested in that video, you can find it on YouTube, and she goes into much greater length. And she's been doing this for over 40 years. This is a study that she's conducted about advertising and its effect on women. So I want to mention a couple of things to sort of summarize some of her findings is, you know, we have seen evidence that here you can look at these. I'll let you read these on your own. But we have seen evidence of the negative effects. Women, especially as Jean mentions, once they hit adolescence, do report experiencing negative effects of so much exposure to female objectification. So I just thought we'd do a real quick journey of women in ads. So real quickly, we see the 40s and 50s. Note the presence of all the writing. Remember, these are old ads. And so even though they're using the persuasive techniques, perhaps, that Bernays taught advertisers, they're very emphasis on writing. And some of these are ridiculous. If your husband ever finds out, I guess you're going to get spanked for buying the wrong coffee. Men wouldn't look at me when I was skinny. And, you know, they have all these, here's another deodorant ads, all these things playing on emotion. Let's move on. Journey of women in the 70s. Now, in the 70s, Americans wrestled with gender equality. There was a battle of sexes going on. Feminism was on the rise. There was a lot of macho male behavior. And so you see that reflected in these ads. Now, these ads are not geared to women. As obnoxious as they are, they're geared towards men. Keep her where she belongs. Blow in her face and she'll follow you anywhere. These are ads geared, probably in a men's magazine, geared towards men who have these feelings, and the ads are playing on their emotions. Hey, I can smoke those cigarettes. They feel the same way I do about feminism. Journey of women in ads in the 1990s. Now, it begins to change. You don't see quite as much sexism, but in the 90s, women were featured differently. Gone are the sexist stereotypes, but they're certainly not about empowerment. The focus is on looking good and being youthful. We can even start to see men objectified in ads as women have been for decades. Is this progress? So journey of women in the ads today, of real change. Marketing campaigns that empower women rather than perpetuating stereotypes are proving to be hits with consumers and highly effective at generating sales. So never forget that these very conscious ad campaigns aren't really about women empowerment. They're about selling you products through the illusion of female empowerment. So we see many different examples here, and this has become more and more popular. This is Gal Gadot, who plays Wonder Woman, a symbol of feminism, I suppose, for some. Liberation only in ads. Advertisers realize that women are seeking greater respect and responsibility in society, which they clearly deserve. And they play on that desire in their ads, okay? You do the girl boss thing, we'll do the SEO thing. I don't know what SEO is. KEDS, ladies first since 1960. So again, appealing to that renewed sense of feminine identity, women seeking and discovering and capturing a greater place financially and career-wise in this world. Budweiser has even gone as far as going back and redoing their ads. So this is from a Budweiser ad campaign. Our country and culture have evolved over time, and advertising should reflect that, which is why this year, in honor of International Women's Day, we are reimagining our ads of the past to better portray the balance and empowerment. Okay, so these are pretty funny. Show her it's a man's world. This is an ad, I guess, for this tie. And then show him it's a woman's world. So they've just gender flipped it. Ads reflect the dominant cultural values of the time. In this way, they make an excellent lens through which to look at culture and history. Here we see modern takes on old ads. So this is a really important point. Ads are going to be manipulative along the dominant culture values. They're not going to come out of pocket with something that most people don't agree on. So if they thought they can get away with this, that's a reflection of, you know, where the consciousness was at the time. And that's why it's important to study. Here's another example. She found that she married two men, I guess, you know, his, you know, the Budweiser and this guy. And then she found she has it all. Okay, so there we go. She's going to drink Budweiser's with her girlfriend. So Budweiser is proud to partner with See Her, an organization devoted to accurate portrayal of women in advertising. Today, only 61% of ads positively portray women. Now, this is a very noble idea, but are they doing it for true women empowerment? Or are they doing it to increase sales of Budweiser? So here's the next question. Discuss the portrayals of women in advertising and how it has changed over time. Discuss the portrayals of women in advertising and how it has changed over time. We were one place and now things have changed. Now, that doesn't mean the sexualization of women has stopped. We still see those ads. I think Carl's Jr. still has those ads, but certainly we've seen a progress. Certainly we've seen a much greater variety in those portrayals, both in terms of gender, empowerment, and equality. So that's the question for question three. Please answer it now, or you can continue with me. All right, moving on. Okay, we're now in our last section. Remember, I said there was going to be four sections this week. That's why we don't have a large homework assignment, because I give you a little more work in the lecture. And that's just because this particular lecture, advertising, it really could be split into two lectures. It's a pretty big topic, and it's one I think the students really like. So here we go. Values and lifestyle system. So this was a system or a way of evaluating consumers. In the 1970s, SRI, now this is out of Stanford University here in California, designed the Values and Lifestyles Program, a novel marketing research tool for determining the motivations behind consumer purchasing decisions. Vals is still used by top advertising agencies today and consumer product marketers worldwide. Vals gave rise to the socially conscious advertising that we see today to attract the youth and not swayed purely by materialism. So we still see this used today. And the things that the Vals identified in the public were really crucial, and those ideas are still employed. So Vals is a marketing tool used to predict consumer behavior based on their philosophical beliefs, mechanical and intellectual curiosity, among other things. Vals is a series of questions to help define target audiences. The audiences are divided into 9 lifestyle groups. There they are listed. We're just going to focus on a few. Each type is thought to behave and consume differently. So let's talk about the 60s, 1960s and 70s. The youth began rejecting materialism of previous generations. Advertisers and corporations were apoplectic. They're like, what's going on? They needed to understand this new generation better to sell to them. The Vals system was created to study these new social trends. So the hippie culture in the 60s emphasized spiritual growth, not material growth. Corporations had to respond. So one example of this, going back to Mad Men, remember we talked about Mad Men, that show. It was the 1950s ad men using manipulative techniques. And the final episode of Mad Men, it ended around the mid-60s in terms of its timeline. The main character, Don Draper, pictured here, who you saw in the previous clip I showed you, goes to the Esalen Institute, which is a very beautiful place in California. Here you see it pictured here on the water in Big Sur with lots and lots of what we would generically call hippie or new age type workshops. He goes there for a workshop. He embraces the culture, ingests it. And at the end of the episode, he later spits out a commercial that was designed to appeal to this culture. And this culture, this commercial, which they showed in the episode, was this famous 1971 advertisement from Coke, in which they sing a song, "I'd like to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony." Now, I remember that ad off the top of my head because it played when I was a child. It's still stuck in my memory, that melody. So this was the ad that Coke came up with to appeal to the hippie generation. Look at the casting. Look at what they're doing with how they're showing off Coke. Coke is cool. Coke is diverse. Coke is world conscious, just like the hippie movement. So to break it down further, the Vals system, designed by Stanford University, divides Americans into the group. We'll just focus on 4 here. Belongers, older, conservative, old-fashioned, more predictable. Emulators, young person searching for an identity. That's going to be most of you in the class watching this. Achievers, successful achievers who buy to exert dominance and remind others of their wealth. Okay, so someone who shows off, who wants to have the Rolex on their wrist or drives in an expensive car, even if they can't totally afford it, because they want to show off that they're an achiever. And lastly, we have the socially conscious consumer or achiever. They're experimental and they're dissatisfied with materialism. Sounds like a hippie. They need to be convinced that their purchase is, number one, opposed to belongers. Remember the conservative older generation that was opposed to hippies back in the day, but that still translates today. And number two, it has to be socially responsible. I'd really like these nice pair of shoes, but I want to know that that company is doing socially responsible things. This is the most important discovery of the VAL system, that, wow, wait a minute. You can actually sell to people if they think your company is a bunch of good guys. If they think your company is cruelty-free, if they're not using slave labor, if they have good morals and they support good causes, they're LGBT friendly, whatever, socially conscious consumer will buy products when they're motivated by even the illusion of participating in something that's socially responsible. Think about that, okay? So let's break it down. The belonger, you know, is going to be attracted to this commercial, easily motivated traditional values, patriotism, heroics. The achiever wants to show off success. So here we see a limo and people dressed in suits. The emulator is searching for identity and products to define them. So a lot of hipster ads are motivated by looking cool and hip. A lot of things that are geared specifically to the young and seem to be not from the older generation. That's going to appeal to the emulator. And of course, the socially conscious person wants ads that, you know, advocate for a green earth and being socially conscious, okay? The belonger, again, going for more traditional ads. If you put a flag on the product, you can sell to a belonger. The achiever, you're going to show off status. Here we have a Rolex. Here we have an expensive perfume, and people, rich, attractive people enjoying their vacation. Okay, appeals to status and what's missing from your life. The emulator ads are going to be hip. Don't be a maybe. I want to be what I want to be. They're all about the consumer as becoming what they hope to be. Well, that's appeals to young people. Most old people have kind of already arrived. So we see hip products, hip clothing, associating themselves with youth culture in ways that may or may not be true, but they do so in their ads. What kind of ads are Gen Z interested in? Here's Old Spice doing a weird sort of kooky ad to appeal to the youth. This isn't designed to appeal to an old man who might use Old Spice. Here they're selling a sort of a cheaper car using sex robots. Not sure what's going on there, Kia. The new mini hipster hatch. Now look at this car. This car is definitely designed for a younger generation. An old person is not likely to buy a car that's so distinct and marked up with these more interesting features, okay? This is for the youth. They're trying to establish their identity and they're trying to discover products that will define them, okay? Lastly, socially conscious advertising. Tom's would say they'd give a free pair of shoes to a poor person in the third world for every pair that you bought. I mean, that is the ultimate. Makes you feel good about buying a new product. Here we see other examples. Socially conscious ads will often be green because being green is associated with being environmentally friendly and aware. The Prius, obviously, advertisers try to appear woke and aware of issues, okay? Socially conscious advertising. So here we see Colin Kaepernick, who famously threw away his NFL career by kneeling and supporting BLM and the rights of African-Americans in America. Here we see We All Belong, mixed race through the split screen. Socialist conscious advertising has become a very popular to match the socially conscious generations buying the products. Companies spend millions to appear woke, far more than actually being woke, okay? So why? Remember, as we said at the beginning, advertisers have been studying the young extensively. 57% of young people believe brands should use their advertising to raise awareness of social or ethical issues. Hello, 57%. Here's more from millennials. Most important factors in deciding to do business with a company. Well, are they socially responsible? Their governance, are they responsible in the environment? Now, it's not huge numbers, it's not a majority, but this is from 2018. These numbers continue to rise. Millennials have been one of the most targeted groups for advertisers. So they know that they have these feelings. They know that this generation and Gen Zs are much more socially conscious and socially progressive than previous generations. So all the woke casting diversity you see on TV is a direct response to the cultural values of millennials and Gen Z. Appealing to diversity in their ads, appealing to diversities in their ads, that companies have had great success by virtue signaling to their customers. The LGBTQ community in particular has shown loyalty to brands who support them or just even have them in their ads. I mean, if you think about it, for years of not seeing gay folks on crowd, LGBT folks, not seeing them in commercials and so forth, all of a sudden you see them in a commercial, it's revolutionary. It makes you have an affinity for the product. It's very successful marketing. Lastly, you know, talking about diversity casting, we see that more and more in ads, appealing to the youth, appealing to the socially conscious, appealing to being hip, non-racist, and cool. Of course, they've got to be all very attractive. This is important to the youth. They're showing this. And here's a different survey from 2019 where 61% of respondents, so this is not just millennials, are saying that importance of diversity in advertisements according to U.S. adults. So 61% that it's say that it's important. And, you know, this has had some ramifications. And it's one of the things that's creating the backlash from rural, conservative, and older consumers. Now, I'm not agreeing with their backlash or anything. I'm just observing that it exists. So casting in ads is crucial. The cast usually reflects the precise audience the commercial is trying to attract. The audience seeing themselves reflected in the cast increases identification and therefore purchases. So advertisers are trying to appeal to the progressive youth with their ads, but those ads are also broadcast to parts of the country in homes where the values are very traditional. Again, not judging, just observing. The changes aren't going away, no matter whatever the protest or the backlash. Younger generations are becoming the dominant consumers in our culture, and their values will be reflected in marketing going forward. Okay. Lastly, real quickly, this is one of the latest issues, the casting of The Little Mermaid. There's been a lot of hubbub. Trevor Noah has been discussing it, and a lot of sort of racist backlash. At the same time, a lot of parents talking about how exciting it was for their young Black daughters to see this casting and see themselves reflected in the protagonists that they see as heroes. Okay, we're gonna start wrapping up here. I know it's been a long lesson, but we've covered a lot of stuff, and I hope it's been interesting to you because you know as much about advertising as I do. So, generational divide in advertising. The youth, technically adapted. The older generation's a little more technically challenged. New media and online, older generation, traditional media. Socially conscious and emulators. This is who the youth are. These are the vows types that they tend to be. Vows types in the older generations, more belongers and achievers. Youth are supporting diversity. Varied opinion on diversity from older generations. The youth are swayed by influencers. Older generations more by figureheads that they've been in their lives for a while. Social media and internet versus television and traditional media. Okay, and this is the big point. The youth are very desirable to marketers. That's why you see the change in the casting and the ads. Older people are slowly fading in their importance to marketers. They've bought all the stuff they need. Young people are just starting to accumulate all the things that marketers want to sell to them. So advertising has unintended consequences. We've talked about that. It promotes consumerism and materialism. It creates FOMO in the public, fear of missing out. Creates a world of illusion and indulgence. Remember, it's the only good news in the paper. It promotes dominant cultural values and standards of living. That's fine if your values don't happen to fall outside the standards. If they do, then you don't see those reflected in the commercials. It promotes stereotypes and trends. This is also true. Clutters cities and roads and minds. Ads, billboards seen everywhere. And of course, it can lead to eating disorders and obesity. Summary of major points. During the 50s, the ideas of Freud entered American popular culture. Advertisers began employing them to sell products. Advertisers realized they could be more successful if they appealed to irrational drives rather than rational drives. Advertise, survey, and spy on customers to understand their desires and sell to them more effectively. Also, of course, tracking their purchases. Surrealism and appeals to emotion are used to distort reality and influence consumers. A false world of endless choice and self-indulgence is created by advertisers. They want you to become an individual completely consumed by your desires, not a participant in a larger society. Sex and fear are common emotional appeals. Lastly, advertising is the dominant art form of the 20th century. Advertising depicts the dreams of the audience, thus creating the desires of the audience. Society has transformed from a literate one to a visual one through the 20th century as print media has faded and the internet, social media, television, movies, anything visual has advanced. And advertising has made manipulation of the masses familiar and immediate. Final word from Noam Chomsky, the public relations and advertising industry, which is dedicated to creating consumers, is a phenomenon that developed in the freest of countries, in Britain and the United States. And the reason is clear. It became evident by a century ago that it was not going to be so easy to control the population by force. And remember, Freud told the leaders that humans have unconscious drives that are hidden. Too much freedom had been won. Labor organizing, parliamentary labor parties in many countries, women starting to get rights, and so on. So you had to have an other means of controlling people. And it was understood and expressed that you have to control them by control of beliefs and attitudes. What better way to do that than through advertising and PR? Okay, final question. It's a big one. What has 70 years of manipulative advertising done to American society? How have we been changed? That's a bigger one. Take a moment to take that in. What has 70 years of manipulative advertising? So we're going back and saying, okay, this has been around since at least the 50s. Really, it's probably more like 100 years. What has it done to American society? How have we been changed? All right. So we're going to stop the share and we're going to get out of this real quick. Whoops, I'm out of focus. See if this works. Anyway, saying goodbye to you from out of focus. I hope you enjoyed this week's lesson. Remember, there's four discussion questions. Look forward to your answers. Reach out with any questions. And as always, have a great week.